In this lesson, we're going to talk about water as a potential source of competition, a potential source of conflict, and at times, a potential opportunity for cooperation. You see, historically, we found that communities, cities, civilizations would tend to grow up alongside a river, a lake, alongside a body of water because of the importance of water to human life, but also because of the importance of water as a means of transportation. That was the historical context, but more recently we see communities growing up in the desert. Los Angeles, Phoenix, Las Vegas. And so we see where there's populations growing, where there's a lack of water. And this has led to a lot of major projects bringing water from some distance away to allow a community to continue to thrive and to further grow. We see this in California, where water comes from far away in California to Los Angeles because of the population there and the need for that water. So we find that in the western part of the United States, there tends to be less rainfall, less water, and so there's more need for moving water to a given community to provide the water that's necessary for livelihood. And there was an organization that was founded called the Bureau of Reclamation, reclaiming the arid West by building dams, reservoirs, water supplies, and pipelines to carry that water some distance to where the population centers were. And there's an excellent book called Cadillac Desert that talks about the process of how all this happened, the challenges, the engineering successes, the social, cultural, and even the political aspects that surrounded this development. A little closer to home, right here in Oklahoma, we see that as we go from the western part of the state of Oklahoma, we have on the order of 10 to 15 inches of rainfall. In the center part of the state, here where Norman, Oklahoma City are, we have 30, 35 inches of rainfall a year. As we go to the eastern side of the state, we get to 50 or more than 50 inches of rainfall a year. And so we have less rainfall, less water in the west, intermediate in the center, and more water on the eastern part of the state. For example, Oklahoma City, half of the water that Oklahoma City relies upon for drinking water comes from Lake Atoka in southeast Oklahoma. That water is pumped 100 miles. There's a pipeline that's 100 miles long that brings that water from Lake Atoka to Lake Draper, which becomes the water supply for half of the water for the city of Oklahoma City. They have to lift that water 500 to 600 feet to get it from Lake Atoka to Lake Draper. The energy cost of moving that water accounts for half the cost of the water for the city of Oklahoma City. As the city has continued to grow, there's a need for additional water, and the city is considering building a second pipeline to a potential cost in the order of $1 billion just for the pipe to get the water. And so you see where the population center is at a different location in the state than where the rainfall is, and so it's a major effort to move the water. Oklahoma City also gets water from Lake Canton. And that water flows, Lake Canton is to the north, northwest of Oklahoma City. That water flows by gravity to the city and provides a major portion of the remaining drinking water for the city. So that's Oklahoma City. What about right here in Norman? Norman's an interesting case where initially the city of Norman relied upon wells, groundwater, for the drinking water for the city of Norman. As the population grew to the point they began to exhaust the groundwater supply that was available at that time, and so Lake Thunderbird was built, Lake Thunderbird 10 miles east of the city of Norman. And that became the dominant source of water for the city, built in the mid-1960s. But eventually, as the city continued to grow more and more, the city is now faced at the point where in the summer, the surface water from Lake Thunderbird and the groundwater from the wells is not sufficient to meet peak demands in the summer. And so the city of Norman finds itself needing to find additional water. In those peak periods now in the summer, the city has to buy surplus water from Oklahoma City to meet those peak demands. And the city of Norman is looking at other options, considering maybe bringing water from 30 miles away, maybe permanently tapping into water that's coming up to Oklahoma City, or possibly taking the wastewater that the city discharges down the Canadian River, the South Canadian River, and as opposed to sending that downstream, maybe taking part of that, treating it to a very high level, and then augmenting the water in Lake Thunderbird. And we'll talk about that more in a future lesson when we talk about water reuse. So we see that sometimes the water that we have available is not in the same location where the population is, and we move the water around as a result. Sometimes this can result in competition and potential conflict. And just to cite a couple of examples, right here in Oklahoma, there's also a lake down in southeast Oklahoma called Sardis Lake, and there's the interest in potentially moving that water to the center part of the state. But it turns out several Native American tribes feel that they have some rights to that water based upon treaties from much earlier. And so there's been some discussion and debate, and there's currently trying to achieve a compromise on the distribution of that water between the native rights and the rights of the people in central Oklahoma. Another example of competition would be with our sister state to the south, the state of Texas. And the state of Texas sees that we have extra water in southeast Oklahoma, and they would like to come across the state line and take some of that water and move it to Texas. In the Arlington-Fort Worth area. This actually resulted in a lawsuit. State of Texas sued the state of Oklahoma over the rights to get that, and this worked its way up to the court and went all the way to the Supreme Court. And ultimately, the Supreme Court determined that the state of Texas did not have the right. They felt like, based on some previous agreements, that right was included in those agreements, but the Supreme Court decided that was not part of those previous agreements, and the state of Texas could not come into the state of Oklahoma to take water into the state of Texas. Competition of another sort is with our sister state to the east, the state of Arkansas. In this case, it's not over water quantity, it's over water quality. The state of Oklahoma feels that certain practices that are taking place in the state of Arkansas are having a negative impact on the water quality in the Illinois River. And currently, the attorney generals of the two states are pursuing an understanding and agreement that will help to satisfy this dispute. And so we see water competition in terms of water quantity or water quality. Well, let's go outside of the state of Oklahoma and outside of the United States. Let's go to China. And China is a very interesting case. We see that in China, 4/5 of the water is in the southern part of the country, whereas half the people and 2/3 of the agriculture is in the northern part of the country. And so again, we have a disparity where the water is not located in the same place as the population or the agriculture. And so China, there's been a number of consequences of this. For example, in Beijing, it's reported that the groundwater level in the area of Beijing has dropped 300 meters since the 1970s, and that's a significant drop in the water table, the groundwater location. Same time, we see that because of this disparity of where the water is versus where the people and the agriculture is, China is undertaking major projects to move water from one location to another. They're looking at 2,000 miles of tunnels and canals and different ways of conveying the water to help move it from the south, where more of the water is, to the north, where half the population and 2/3 of the agriculture is. So this is a case where we have movement of the water within the country of China because of the disparity of where the water is versus where the people and agriculture are. Well, now let's think about when the water is located in different levels in different countries, and one country might look to another country and say, I'd like to have some of that water. If you look at this table, the center column indicates the amount of water that a country has, and the column to the right indicates the percentage of that water that they use. Canada has so much water that it uses only 1% of its water. The United States has about 1/10 of the amount of water that Canada has, and so it uses 19%, approaching 20% of its water. China, which obviously has a population much greater than U.S. or Canada, has about 1/4 as much water as the United States has. Water use is lower per capita, and so it uses 16% of its water. And so as we look at this, we can see that different countries have different amounts of water. Down lower in this table, we see that Egypt uses 97% of its water. It has to use every drop of water it has available. And you might wonder, how can Libya use 300% of its water? How can it use more water than it has? And that can be because of importing water from other areas, from other countries, and it can be because they reuse their water, because they have such a great demand relative to the supply that they have. For example, the United States and Mexico. The United States has a heavy reliance in the arid West on the water in that region, and specifically the Colorado River water. And so the United States pulls a good amount, the states and people in that area pull a good amount of water from the Colorado River, to the point that by the time the Colorado River gets to Mexico, there's very little and almost no water remaining. And so that's obviously creates a potential conflict between the United States and Mexico. Mexico needs water as well. And so you have treaties that come about between the countries to make agreements about water use and water passage. Another example of multiple countries and a water that flows through them is Ethiopia and Egypt. It turns out that the headwaters where the water, the most upstream place where the water begins that helps to create the Nile River is in Ethiopia. And then that water flows through the country of Egypt. Well, Ethiopia needs water. But it turns out, due to a treaty that was agreed to many years ago under colonial times, Egypt has rights to the water that supersede the rights of Ethiopia. So the Ethiopians have this uncomfortable situation of allowing this water to flow through their country that they could have great use for, because they need to allow it to flow to Egypt. And you can understand how this could be a potential source of conflict. And there are a number of other cases. One other example would be Singapore and Malaysia. Singapore is a country, an island country, a city-state, and it's just south of Malaysia. Well, it used to be that Singapore had to rely upon water from Malaysia to meet the water demands for Singapore. And this was an uncomfortable position. You were relying upon another country to provide you something so valuable, so vital to livelihood as water. And Singapore struggled with what can we do to address this. And so what Singapore decided to do was to rely upon water reuse. Singapore now takes their wastewater and they treat it to a very high level and they put it back into their water supply system. And we call this water reuse or water reclamation. Now this didn't happen all at once. This happened over more than a decade of time, and there was public education, there was public awareness, there were demonstration projects. But the city of Singapore now has developed water independence. We talk about oil independence, not relying upon other countries for oil. Well, Singapore wanted to be water independent and took this step to enable it to do so. So we've talked about how water can be a potential source of competition. Multiple countries needing water, one country wanting water that another country has. It's an interesting fact, though, that whereas in many other resources, we can think of mineral resources or oil or any other resources where this competition leads to conflict. Water has a unique characteristic in that it's been found that often water leads to cooperation or agreements. And so a colleague, Aaron Wolf at Oregon State University, has documented over 300 international treaties that have come together where multiple countries are agreeing on the distribution of water to meet the mutual needs. And so we see that water has a special characteristic to it that tends to bring cooperation, whereas in other settings we might see conflict result as the countries are vying over limited resources. So water has potential competition, potential conflict, but also has the potential to bring countries together. And so water is very unique in this respect.